1976 is a great year for America Watchers. The bicentennial and presidential election bring us a festival of self-congratulation and optimistic appraisals of where the American system is taking us. For example, the editors of Fortune magazine see the system as a pattern of national development, constantly evolving, constantly widening the boundaries of individual freedom, a pattern which has not only carried the United States to primacy among nations, but has inspired a similar liberating thrust throughout the rest of the world. I believe the answer is not self-evident or so positive. The United States is a complex blend of people, actions, and ideals whose strength is its diversity. Understanding is complicated by the fact that virtually 100% of the information about us comes from the successful upper third of American society, and it naturally reflects their positive experiences in the system. Yet there are ways to understand what endures, what is changing, and who is served by our national development. One key way is to look at how we've shaped our urban environment for human uses. City building is a major theme in American history, and with industrialization, it has been our principal mode of development for over 150 years. In modern America, the city is the people. Over 80% of all Americans alive in the century have lived in the urban mosaic. It is where we have pursued our major common values, such as innovation and competition, mobility, personal enhancement, as well as community, democracy, and equity. In short, the city is our best evidence of drastic changes, persistent problems, and underlying norms in bicentennial America. From an airplane, your first impression might be of the vast, diverse land which surrounds and permeates American cities. These 2.3 billion acres are in the following uses. 58% are agricultural uses, crops and livestock. 22% ungrazed forest lands. 12% are in limited surfaces, swamp, desert, tundra. 5% is in recreation and wilderness parks, wildlife reserves, and flood control. Only 3% is in urban and transportation uses combined. 12% of all land today is actually inside superurban regions, but 3/4 of that is open space. Originally, the federal government organized this land into units that became the geographic basis of our politics, and then sold or gave most of it away in rectangular portions that established the grid pattern of our farms and cities. Since the United States takes a less centralized approach to national development than do most countries, the land is controlled primarily by local governments and is exploited as a commodity by private interests working for personal gain on the assumption that social well-being will follow. American urban patterns began when the first colonists set off small, integrated regional networks of central port, villages and farms in a vast landscape. By 1900, this pattern of cultural provinces had been repeated along rail and water lines across the continent, and the United States had become an urbanized, industrialized nation. But the city's form kept changing, and in fact, four distinct forms of American city successively evolved. The commercial city was the major form until about mid-19th century. City and downtown were synonymous. Boston in 1800 was a geographically and socially compact walking city, which began at the bay and fanned back in a 2-mile radius containing most of the city's activities: business and government, church, work, and residence. A series of smaller cities, towns, and farms sent raw materials to and received finished products from the hub, as Boston was called. Because of spatial limits, the first big industries were constructed 20 or more miles away in special factory towns, linked by road and water to Boston. Social contacts were close, direct, and personal in this kind of geographically limited city. Despite extreme social inequities, laborers lived in alleys behind the main streets where the more well-to-do resided. Since all lived and worked inside of each other, public behavior was regulated primarily by informal means of approval and disapproval. Political leadership came almost exclusively from the social and economic elite, elected at town meetings to represent the whole city. industrial city which supplanted it contained at least two physical characteristics which have marked American urban form distinctively ever since. Steady expansion of boundaries and sharp division of space into functional zones and socially discrete neighborhoods. By 1850, Boston had separate commercial, factory, and residential districts. The last were further subdivided into neighborhoods along class, income, ethnic, religious, and racial lines. Immigrants settled in national groups near downtown jobs and cheap housing. Native whites with higher incomes relocated in newer but still dense housing around them. And the city's elite built spacious new neighborhoods on the periphery. Thus began our association of outward geographic with upward social mobility. Each of these social territories contained schools, recreation, real estate, bank, retail, and other small resident-owned enterprises whose owners had a vital interest in the neighborhood's condition, stability, and growth. Cheap, fast public transportation made the physical expansion possible. American social differences, group needs, and the intense competitive struggle created the discrete neighborhoods. Social contacts and control became quite decentralized. Wars became the focus of politics, and their leaders forged strong neighborhood organizations providing jobs, welfare services, school control, protection, and access to City Hall in exchange for votes. For the first and only era in American urban history, middle and lower classes greatly outnumbered the elite on the city council. The council's main concern was physical development, but there was little public planning. They argued over subdivision approval, building priorities, taxes, licensing, regulation, and so on. In short, it was a democratic division of spoils. Some historians today believe the so-called machine politics was the ultimate in citizen participation. Sensitive to neighborhood needs, the machine extended the urban infrastructure to all citizens and directed the American city to its greatest era of political democracy. However, while the social and political systems decentralized, the economic system did not. On the contrary, the economy was organized into ever larger systems of financing and production, distribution and merchandising, which consumed the best downtown spaces. Centralization became dominant about 1900 with the emergence of the metropolitan area. Urban space was doubled as large, politically independent suburbs became a permanent feature. But the sharpest contrasts were inside the city. It had really become two cities. One for managers and one for workers. The first thing to go in Chicago was downtown as a residential area for the lower middle classes, especially for Black Americans and other new migrants from rural areas who replaced immigrants after 1915. Increased ground rents made living downtown unfeasible for most people. Corporate headquarters were separated from factories and relocated in office skyscrapers of the Central Loop, near large retail stores, City Hall, banks, and other special services. With them came tall luxury hotels and apartments along Lake Michigan. Behind them spread miles of slums, ghettos, and factories. Gray areas bordering on commercial strips and tangled rail lines. This was probably the most environmentally chaotic period in American urban history. In losing its diverse residential mix to economic growth at any social cost, downtown was no longer a 24-hour show. Technology was the force in the city's expansion and in the increased speed and flexibility of communications. However, the The most revolutionary change was a subtle shift from territorial to functional lines of organization, which integrated economic and political control at the highest levels and created a superstructure of people and contracts at the top. The upper classes were back in control, joined by a new class of management professionals and experts seeking a stable, manipulatable, and rationally planned society. These reformers energetically preserved their own communities, but they were reckless of others as they shifted control of politics, schools, and planning from ward to citywide jurisdictions. By reducing the number of decision makers while expanding the staff function, they were better able to plan comprehensively and to protect their vision of the social good from the sometimes more conservative, always more divisive, and naturally more democratic vision of the majority population. Thus, they built civic centers, metropolitan park and street systems, industrial satellites, expensive suburbs, and shopping centers for themselves. And they replaced the lower income neighborhoods they destroyed with massive apartment complexes devoid of basic services, open space, or social cohesion. In effect, they were streamlining American democracy without changing it fundamentally. Far from redistributing information, power, and affluence, the new leadership made the American system more remote, awesome, and difficult for ordinary citizens to change. These trends continue in the huge urban regions which have appeared since 1945. The actual city is now a conurbation, several hundred miles square of large and small cities, suburbs, towns, and farms containing millions of people living and dead. The biggest incorporated city is Oklahoma City, whose 636 square miles cover parts of five counties. More typical, however, is the 7,500 square mile megalopolis of Greater Los Angeles, where human movement is more circular than radial. It contains over 1,000 separate governments, plus the central city. Two-thirds of downtown is in auto-related uses. Traffic pollutes the air and tall buildings trap it. Parking lots bring huge profits but few taxes. Ground rents keep spiraling and neighborhoods are riddled by freeways. The inheritors of this unsafe shell must somehow make do with a declining tax base, few in-city jobs, moribund public transport, decaying schools, social services, and neighborhood institutions. The 1970 census details this spatial shift. There are at least 15 super cities. Over 60 well-planned regional new towns are being built, primarily for upper-income groups. 75% of all new jobs are now located in suburbia, and 75% of the people who live there also work there. More Americans live in suburbia than anywhere else. 31% live in central cities, and another 27% live in smaller cities and towns just outside these urban regions. Only 5% of Americans are farm residents, that's under 10 million people, and half of them work in towns and cities. With zero population growth, a full 20% of our annual net population gain now comes from immigration again. There are slightly more immigrants than farmers. Suburbia itself is more diversified than central city in income, occupation, ethnicity, religion, housing choice, entertainment, commerce, open space, and even offices. Everything except race. The 16% of blacks who do live in suburbs are in predominantly black neighborhoods. Functional and social zoning of the nation is more pronounced than ever. Americans still separate and protect their communities from integrating forces. Most suburbs have independent political status, which is used to buy services which residents don't want to start on their own, to reject metropolitan and regional government, and to keep out racial minorities, the poor, and other unwanted populations. Racial minorities in central city neighborhoods have been forced to concentrate in limited areas. But this also has the effect of giving spatial community form to their drives for civil rights. Black Americans have been especially successful at making their views known, and they are showing other urbanites how to reorganize their neighborhoods for political purposes. Militancy reached a crescendo of 104 revolts in 23 cities in the first 9 months of 1967. Less known is the people's move from street protests to well-organized programmatic politics. They have created legally incorporated neighborhood councils able to raise funds, to sue and exert political pressure, and to obtain inside information with which to fight bureaucracies and corporations more effectively. But neither suburbs nor city neighborhoods are a match for the entrenched American leadership. In the public sector, they have created limited purpose agencies which are relatively free of electoral influence and have funds and powers of eminent domain independent of local governments. In the private sector, spiraling costs, tax imperatives, and development priorities have made giant corporations, labor unions, and universities the major owners of urban property. The most significant planning is downtown and on freeways, which continue to destroy lower-income communities, leaving individuals without a social base and with few housing alternatives, basic services, green space, access to work, and other necessities of life. The failure of advocacy planning, model cities, and other neighborhood renewal efforts only accents the point that power, not need, makes change. When communities do react, they generally must do so openly and alone. Officials can hide, stall, counter-thrust, shift responsibility, seek more information, and create advisory groups where people are consulted and receive limited information, but have no legal means of sharing power and influence. Nevertheless, there are some important lessons to learn from community efforts. The basic issue is the struggle for control of space and well-being by the majority population, black and white, who are angry at bearing the burden of reforms made by those who are rarely affected themselves. The system says grow. People say prosper. They see the power and income pyramids and know that equal opportunity is not enough. The system is an escalator for vertical mobility. Leadership blames the victim or his background, never the system, when a person fails to rise. But today's victim demands equality of results. They're dissatisfied with corporate views of well-being and with government's failure to solve historically persistent problems, despite an investment of billions in public funds and hundreds of programs. These efforts have increased public awareness of the importance of societal improvement, but the public sees only minimal basic change. They're saying very clearly, leave our subcultures alone. But provide us the same means to live as the top third gives itself. So if it is clear who owns and runs America, so is public dissatisfaction with the results. Thus, the struggle for a fresh approach continues. The United States is blessed with great natural resources, people from every part of the world, and ideals of human equality based on fair competition and local democracy. Yet, perhaps no nation so blessed has more difficulty in working out its purposes democratically. The American city demonstrates this. Its development is increasingly large-scale, centralized, impersonal, cosmopolitan, and uniform, whereas daily living remains small-scale, segmented, personal, parochial, and very uneven. Now, how should we proceed amid this tension of cross-purposes? Several conclusions can be drawn. We are not running out of land, as some environmentalists claim, but our methods of development are wasteful and inequitable. Some coordinated form of regional and neighborhood planning is especially needed. Now, despite our blusters about individuality, urban expansion has also clarified the tendency of Americans to gather in small, physically discrete, socially homogeneous communities and interest groups where they can preserve their identity, promote local control, and establish a political base for their members in the intense and unequal struggle for power and affluence in America. As an eminent historian says, what held Americans together was their ability to live apart. Society depended upon segmentation. From this elementary principle emerged a pattern of beliefs and behavior that was recognizably American. Now, what has been missing is a permanent grassroots element in decision-making, starting at the local neighborhood level where people actually live. The people's formal participation in politics would certainly decrease the murderous efficiency, probably change the imbalance of priorities, and would certainly increase the divisiveness, which is already characteristic of American negotiations. It also would be inclusive and direct. Democracy is untidy by definition, but untidiness is not the problem. Who should participate is. We know how the American system should function in a world of cross purposes. For example, the jazz you hear is the most authentic and wholly urban form of American music. It is a form in which, at its best, each player seems to be and has a sense of being on his own. Each goes his own way, inventing rhythmic and melodic patterns which, superficially, seem to have little relation to one another. And yet the outcome is a dazzling, precise, creative unity. So too, the most common symbolic habitat portrayed by our artists, writers, urban designers, and other image makers is the middle landscape, the search for an intensely private, prosperous, small-scale life with the advantages of both supercity and nature. Our artists leave us the more vivid and articulate record of their feelings than most people do, but the message is evident throughout American civilization. The city is not just a problem to be solved. It is an experience to share. The more equitably shared, the better that city for all of us.